Good morning, everybody. It's good to see y'all, and we're gonna start it off, our service off today with singing a patriotic number, God Bless America. And when we get through singing it the first time, we're gonna ask you to stand and join us as we sing just the chorus to God Bless America.
Hope everyone's had a good week, hopefully expecting some good things, hopefully this morning. And when we think about the song we just sang, one, it is about patriotism, which is in itself a good thing, I believe. But it's also a prayer in a sense. If you think about it, you're singing something, asking God to bless something. Does that make sense? So it's almost a prayer. And so I thought it would be appropriate for us to pray for our country and our leaders in this moment. I am thankful for the freedoms that we enjoy that so many people do not. I'm more thankful for the freedoms that we have in Christ who has forgiven us from our sins. But when we think about the country that we live in, we can be honest and love our country, but also realize it's not the country that we would want sometimes. And it's definitely not the country that God would have for us to be. And so if we're going to sing God Bless Our Country, let's pray for ourselves and our leaders and our nation and pray that we would be obedient to share the gospel, to send the light that God has given us and gifted us with and blessed us with to take to the people that we know. Because sharing the gospel is a great way to love our neighbor, and loving our country is a way to love our neighbor. So they kind of actually go together, don't they? And so if you would, I'd love for you to join me as we pray for our nation and our leaders. Lord, thank you again for blessing us so much with the country that we live in, not just the country, but even our state and our community. God, we know and we recognize that the freedoms that we hold dear, that we get the chance to treasure, are freedoms that for a certain amount, we haven't really done anything to earn or to deserve. But we thank you for the freedoms we have as Americans, God. Freedoms to worship and to assemble, to do what we're doing, even right now where there are other brothers and sisters around our world that don't have what we have. I pray that we would not take our freedoms and our liberties for granted, but that we would enjoy them and understand that you have blessed us with them. God, we do pray for our country, that our country would be a country that was devoted to the gospel and devoted to your son, God, that it would be a country that loved its neighbors and served them, God, that we really would be a shining light in the world, but also that our own churches would just be shining lights in our country. And God, we pray that you would give us the strength and wisdom to love our neighbors and to serve them as best we can. And God, we do thank you again for blessing us. But God, we pray that we would not allow our blessings that you blessed us with to remain hidden, but that we would take those blessings and bless others. Lord, we do love you. God, we thank you for our country. God, be with our leaders as they lead, as they make decisions that affect so many. God, we pray that they would all turn to you, that they would understand the gospel, that they would read their Bibles, God, that they would pray, that they would be devoted to you, God. But we pray more so that all of us here this morning would do the same, that we would be obedient to love and to serve you in all things. God, we do love you, God. We thank you for the freedoms that we have. And God, I pray again that we just would not take those things for granted, God. Lord, continue to be with our service even this morning as we continue. Lord, we love you. We thank you for Christ, and it's in his name that we pray. Amen. I was telling some folks earlier, like, you've got to learn the rhythms of the church, and I feel so awkward right now, okay? So I'm going to let him continue to do the announcements and stuff for a little bit till I get a little bit more comfortable. I was looking for you. I got lost. All right.
We're going to have it. Good to see everybody here this morning on such a great Sunday morning, and like to just welcome you to our service. And if you're also visiting with us for the first time, like to welcome you especially. And there's a visitor's card in there somewhere in the pew that you can fill out. We'd love to have a record of your visit. Just a couple of announcements. First off, Mr. Danny Welch has got a mission project plan, looks like, for July the 17th. It'd be in Morton at Life Spring Church. It's a church we've helped in the past. Matter of fact, we just built a shower and stuff for them. And we're going to leave at 6:30 a.m. Is that right, Mr. Danny? That'll be a Saturday morning. And if you want to go and be a part of that, just contact Mr. Danny. I'm pretty sure he'd love all the help that he could get in that area. So also, several announcements. You look in your bulletin, you can see going to have a housewarming honoring Brother Adam and his family July the 25th. At 2 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall. You can also see there are some deacon nomination things in there, several things if you'll be looking at that are coming up. Also, Sunday school this morning, we had 143. Last week was 127, and last year at this time was not available because we were not meeting for Sunday school. At this moment, we are going to pause and we're going to take up a love offering for Miss Linda Weathersby and family. So remember Miss Linda, pray for Miss Linda, lift her up. Remember Mr. Robert, Alex, and James and the rest of the family. I know it's just a difficult time right now, but remember Miss Linda and her family, especially as you give this morning. So I'm going to ask at this time if our ushers or whoever would come forward so we can do that. And then Miss Doris, if you would play. And then at the end of that, we're going to pray. And as I pray out loud, I would just like for you to lift up Miss Linda and her family in this time. As a matter of fact, let's just go ahead and pray now. So as I pray out loud, you pray for Miss Linda and her family. Father God, we love you so much and so thankful for the opportunity to lift up Miss Linda. And Father God, we know you're there. We know you're all around. You're working, you're moving, you're holding her, and I thank you for it. I just pray for peace and comfort during this time for her, Father God. She is such a testimony, such a light to all those she comes in contact with. So thank you for her ministry that she's had, and thank you for the friendship that I've been able to develop with her over the last 5 years, Father God. I just pray for her family as well. Strengthen them during this time, Father God, and that I pray more than anything that your will is done, just like it is in heaven. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Beautiful music. 641. We're going to sing all patriotic songs today, but we're going to give honor to God for the freedom we have. America the Beautiful, 641. Sing the first and fourth stanzas, please.
Brotherhood from sea to shining sea.
next door, page 642, God of our fathers, whose almighty hand, 642. Singing 646 would be our offertory, please. I ask you to stand, please, as we sing. Ushers, will you come forth on the fourth stanza, please?
My country, tis of the spring land of liberty, of thee I sing.
Be seated.
Thank you. timeless theme. Earth and heaven will pass away. It's not a dream. God will make all things new that day. Gone is the curse from which I stumbled and fell. Evil is banished to eternal hell. No more light, no more pain, no more tears, never crying again, and praises to
Again, that's a tough act to follow. Revelation 21, that's really where most of that song comes from. I just want to read it real quickly. It says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more." And then it says, "I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man, and he will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God.'" And then it says, "He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away." And then it says, "And he who was seated on the throne said, 'Behold, I am making all things new.'" We are reminded in days like today that we are not there yet. We are in a fallen world with problems and sin and disease and sickness and cancer and death. And we are reminded that we are not there yet. There is a coming day. That day is not today. But there is a day coming where that will be the truth. And so we are thankful for that great reminder in that song. Thank you for that. If you would, I'd invite you to turn to the book of Nehemiah, Old Testament, okay? A book in the Old Testament. Quite possibly my favorite book of the Bible. And as you're turning there, we'll just kind of say a few things. One, I just want to say thank you for those that came and helped us move this yesterday. And it was quite a bit to do and lots of help. And I just want to say thank you. There'd be too many people to name because if I tried, I would forget. So I don't want to do that. So you know who you are. So I want to say thank you so much. It was a very big blessing. Give us a little bit of time to get settled in. But we are really excited to be here this morning. And so as I was looking back over the last couple weeks, really preparing for this Sunday, I didn't know where I wanted to be my first Sunday. I knew eventually we're going to be in the book of Nehemiah through a sermon series because I think the best way to be faithful to God's word is really just to go through a book of the Bible. Okay, we're gonna walk systematically through a book. We're just going to pick up where we left off. It's going to be real simple for us to know where we're going to be next week because we're just going to pick up where we left off. Now, there will be some times where God will make me change that, but we're going to be in the book of Nehemiah for a couple of months, and there's a lot going on in the book, okay? There really is. And so, after thinking about just last week was a kind of a stressful week, and, you know, you box stuff up, and then you think you're good, and then you think, well, wait a minute, I shouldn't have boxed that up, and then you're like, I need that, and don't know where it is, and you kind of got to go through that, and Laurie and my oldest daughter, they were in Orlando most of the week for a beta convention, and so it just was a long, stressful week, everything kind of prepping up till tomorrow, or yesterday, rather, where we were gonna go, and I wasn't going to start this book series this week, but I just kind of felt like that's what we needed to do. And so Nehemiah is an interesting book, and a lot of people think the book is pretty much just about leadership. And there is a lot to say about leadership in the book of Nehemiah. There really is. And so that's somewhat true, but there's more to it than that. And the book of Nehemiah is about a group of people that got on mission doing what God had called them to do, and they were trusting that what they did, God was going to bless. That's the story of Nehemiah. And so there's a lot there my hope is that there's a lot there in the book that should apply to us today. Now, my hope is that as we start this new season of ministry together, okay, that we would all be willing to endeavor to do whatever God would see us to do together, faithfully, trusting God to bless what it is we do. Because really and truly, that's how churches do what they're supposed to do. It's not about leadership. It's not necessarily about this. It's not about this character and this person and this ministry or this or that. It's really about doing what God has called us to do, but doing it together. I mean, that's the health of a church is defined by people, a body, doing what God has called them to do. And so my hope is that we look in the book that we'll see some of those principles that we can learn from it, okay, in order to do that. Now, if you think about a church, though, there's a lot of different types of people in a church, isn't it? Young people, old people, rich people, poor people, right? There's people that vote this way on a particular topic and people that vote this way. There are family trees and there are people that live in different parts of the area. There's lots of different people, and that's a good thing. That's one of the beauties of the local church, is that we're all different, okay? And if you really think about it, outside of family, a church is made up of a group of people that outside of the gospel and outside of the church, they probably really wouldn't spend a lot of time together. You ever think about that? Outside of the family units and the connections that you have, generally speaking, most of the people we would hang out with are pretty much like us, aren't they? But the church brings a bunch of different groups of people together that are different backgrounds and perspectives. And God uses those backgrounds and perspectives to do great things. One of the pastors that I respect, named Alistair Begg, and he's one of the great preachers alive, but he once gave a list of four types of people in a church that do not really contribute to the overall health of the church. And so I want to list those four groups that he gives as a way to introduce our text, okay? So four groups that are in a church that don't necessarily contribute. First, he said there was a group called the relaxers. There's a group in the church that are relaxers. And they are a group that kind of feel like, well, they've kind of arrived, right? They've arrived. They don't get too bothered about things because, well, they've seen an awful lot in the life of their church. And a lot of these folks used to do a lot of different things, but now they don't, because there's a group that kind of feels like, well, I've already served my time. I've done that. I no longer need to do anything. And sometimes we see people like that. And let me just be clear real quick for my first Sunday. Like, there is never a moment, if we're in the church, the body of Christ, that we don't need to serve and do something. Okay? If you're alive, you got a heartbeat, you're breathing, we got stuff to do together. Okay? That's why it's good to have different perspectives and life experiences. And as I said, kind of the Sunday we came in view of a call, like I said, like, young people, you need the older people in this church. Older people, you need the young people. Right? Like, it's a family dynamic because we're all the body. But there are a group that kind of feel like, well, I've served my time, I'm good. The second group that Begg, he refers to is the investigators. Now, these are people that don't really do a lot. They just want to know everything that's going on. Right? They don't really care. They just want to know. Right? They're not necessarily serving. They just want to be kept up to speed. To an extent, these people love the church calendar. So don't forget the church calendar, because they want to know everything that's going on. They don't necessarily want to do a lot, but they want to know. The third group that Begg brings up about that kind of help keep a church from growing, according to him, is the agitators. Now, I don't know, we were moving my washer and dryer in, and my dryer is an extra large because I got three kids and they're all girls, so we have lots of costume clothes changes throughout the week, right? And any guy that has daughters, you know what that's like. So we bought a big one. The problem was, when we bought it, it wouldn't fit through the door. So I have to disassemble it to get it in, and then I had to disassemble it to get it out. Now I still have to reassemble it to use it, okay? But in the washer, you have the thing in the middle, and it's called an agitator. And what does an agitator do? It moves back and forth, and what does it do? It works against the clothes to get the dirt and stuff out. It's not just the water that cleans the clothes. It's the agitator. Well, they're always bouncing back and forth, rubbing things the wrong way. And to a certain extent, we can see people like that in the church, can't we? Agitators. They're kind of critical sometimes, and they don't necessarily want to know everything, but they're almost like, in my life, and I was a football coach for a while, my wife's a coach, and I've always seen people that were just like referees, right? Like referees, and I know we have some experience in referees in the church, but referees in life are people that just go around tooting their whistle at everybody. You messed up. That's the whole point of a referee, to say, you shouldn't have done that. And sometimes churches can have people like that. They don't serve, they don't help, they just go around blowing a whistle telling you how all the stuff you're doing wrong. And that doesn't contribute to the health of a church. And then the last group he brings up is this group called the expectors. It's a group that's always looking about what's next. Now, in a simple sense, that's a good thing, because we need to expect great things from the Lord. We do. And I hope that you do as well. But sometimes by looking at what's over there or what's ahead, we miss out on the blessings that we have today. God has blessed this church immensely. God has blessed you as an individual immensely. And we don't ever want to be so cold about what God has done now by looking so far ahead that we miss out on what God would have for us now. Now, I've seen all different types of people like this in ministry. But when you think about church and doing what God has called us to do, I think Nehemiah illustrates two types of people that we need to be. So let's not worry about the kind of people that we don't need to be, although that is important. Instead, let's look at the two types of people that we need to be if God's going to bless our efforts. And really what we see in Nehemiah is two types of people. We see servants and leaders. That's it. If you want to be a healthy church, we need to be a people that are servants and leaders. Now, even in these different groups, we have different personalities, right? We need people that are critical. There's nothing wrong with criticism if it's justified, right? We can always do things better or do things different or make some changes if we need to in order to be the church that God's called us to be. And make no mistake, there will be some things that need to change. Nothing crazy big. I'll just be honest. I'm not a person that believes you change things for change's sake. That's crazy. Right? But we can always be better at what we do. We can always be more proficient. But a church really needs servants and leaders. And so I want you to think about that already this morning. What kind of person are you? Are you a leader or are you a servant? Because generally speaking, you're one of these two or you're one of the four. If we're not serving, right? If we're not serving or leading, what are we doing? Are we just consuming? Are we just coming to church to get something, get our ears tickled, or to get a, you know, I remember as a kid, you know, you go to Sunday school and you get those little gold stars by your attendance. Like, I understand the point of that, but it almost kind of taught our kids, well, you just show up for the sticker. Instead of we show up to worship Jesus who's died on the cross for us and saved us of our sins, and we come together to gather and fellowship in Christian community, which is one of the things that last year has taught us that we have sorely messed up because people have gotten used to not fellowshipping and gathering together. It's an important thing. But we need to have servants and leaders. I'm excited about this next season of ministry here, and I hope that you guys are as well. But if we're going to move ahead together, doing what God's called us to do together here, we're going to need servants and we're going to need leaders. And it's with that in mind that I want to get into the book of Nehemiah chapter 1 by focusing in a little bit on servants and leaders. So if you would, let's read together starting in Nehemiah chapter 1 verse 1. And it says, the words of Nehemiah, the son of Hakaliah. Now it happened in the month of Chislev, in the 20th year, as I was in Susa, the citadel, that Hanani, one of my brothers, came with certain men from Judah. And I asked them concerning the Jews who escaped, who had survived the exile, and concerning Jerusalem. And they said to me, the remnant there in the province who had survived the exile is in great trouble and shame. The wall of Jerusalem is broken down, and its gates are destroyed by fire. The first seven chapters of Nehemiah are just his own personal record. Just think, it's his own personal journal. Now, there's a lot of value and wisdom in journaling, isn't it? Some of you probably do that. There's a lot of good value in writing these things down. And so what we're getting firstly from the first seven chapters is just Nehemiah saying this is what happened. In fact, half of the book is just personal record. And as we'll find out in the next chapter, we'll look at that next week, at the end of this chapter, okay, I'm going to want to read the last part. It says, now I was cupbearer to the king. That helps you understand what he's just wrote, okay? He's the cupbearer of the king. And here's what a cupbearer of the king does. He drinks the wine, eats the food for the king, just to make sure no one's trying to poison him. And you think you have a tough job, right? He would eat the food, drink the wine. He was also probably over the kitchen and made sure everything was cooked. But he would eat, and there everyone would just wait on him to die. That was his job. So something tells me that the king trusted the guy, right? Like he had to have been trusted to be entrusted with that job. So here he is working in the king's court in Babylon. This is after the time of the book of Daniel, okay? When they had, when the Jews and Israel and Jerusalem had been destroyed and taken into captivity, all right? And so they are in a foreign country, and here he is, kind of like the king's right-hand man. And so while Daniel's working, Hananiah, it says, one of his brothers, I don't think that's literally one of his brothers, that just means one of his kinsmen, he comes and he's giving a status report of home. How's home? How's Jerusalem, he asked. How's everything going? And Jerusalem here is thousands of miles away. But Nehemiah here is still very much concerned about his home country. Here it is, July 4th, right? We can celebrate a lot of good things, but we can still be concerned about our country. That's completely right and proper. Here, Nehemiah is concerned about his home. And to be honest with you, if you think about it, he models a little something that we all should have. We all should have concern for people other than us, huh? We should all be concerned about people outside of our zip code. And we should be concerned about people on the other side of the planet. We should also be concerned with our neighbors, the people around us that God has given us. But Nehemiah models great care and concern for people. And so Daniel asks, how are those people that have survived? How are they doing? And here's the answer. He says, Hananiah says, those who had survived are in great trouble and shame. And then he says, and the walls of Jerusalem have been burned down, have been destroyed, and the gates have been burned. Now, we lose a lot of this in 2021, okay? We don't get this much because of the day we live in. But walls during that day were crucial to a city's safety, security. In fact, according to historical record, you could not be considered a city in that day if you didn't have walls. It kept people out. It kept the right people in. It kept you safe from bandits. It was just crucial to your success. In fact, if you remember in the book of Joshua, when they go around Jericho, it was so intimidating, not because of the size of the city, but because of the size of the walls. That's why God had to do what he did in order for the people to win. So they offered protection and security, right? But they also made it possible for the people to cultivate their lives. Where was the temple? Inside the city walls. So if you didn't even have a wall around Jerusalem, you couldn't be safe going to church. This is a big deal. With the walls broken, there could be no church, no city, no country, no family, no security, nothing. If you would think about it, it would be much like the way New Orleans was after Katrina. There was no safety, there was no power, there was nothing. It was just what? Chaos. That's what it was. So Nehemiah gets this, but what's interesting for him is that Nehemiah, working in the king's court, I think he already knew this. Think about it. If you're the right-hand man to the most powerful person politically on the face of the planet, something tells me you know what's going on in the world. He already knew this. But then notice how he responds. Look at verse 4 with me. As soon as I heard these words, I sat down and wept and mourned for days, and I continued fasting and praying before the God of heaven. So he gets this news, and it just breaks him. Have you ever been in a season of life that was what defined you? Just weeping, and mourning, and praying, and fasting. Saying, God, I don't understand this. Or saying, God, I don't know where you would have me to go. I don't know what you would have me to do. I'm broken as a person. And so you pray and you mourn seeking the Lord. He's heartbroken. Now, I've already said that he probably would have already known this because of his job. But what makes this even more incredible is that Jerusalem had been destroyed roughly 141 years earlier. This is not new news for Nehemiah. This is something that happened generations ago. Imagine me coming to you this morning, or somebody coming to you this morning and said, guys, I got some bad news. Abraham Lincoln was assassinated. And all of us just being broken over it. You would probably think, well, like, I know that was bad, but I remember that. I heard about it. I mean, you know, might not have went to the best school, but I remember that that is an event that happened. This is basically something similar. He's like, this is 141 years earlier, and here he is, heartbroken. I think that's important. Nehemiah gets old news that he'd already heard before, but for probably the first time in his life, it breaks his heart. He weeps, he mourns. As we've already seen, Nehemiah is a person that cares for people. He's a man defined by great concern and care. He genuinely cares for people. But if you think about this way, Nehemiah simply gets old news in a new way. And I'm going to get to this here in a second. But how often are we just numb and dead to the things around us? How many times do we think, well, that's just the way things are? Well, maybe they shouldn't be. You know, maybe this is the way our family acts, or this is the way my neighbors are. I'm just only human, that's what I do. We use these excuses to not be faithful. And Nehemiah, I think, is getting convicted. He's like, you know what, you're right. My hometown's destroyed. The people I love and am concerned about are messed up in pain, and it breaks his heart. And I believe, if we're going to be the church that God's called us to be, there's going to be times where we're going to need to be a little heartbroken about some things. And there'll be times that we're going to need to say, well, you know, that may be the way things always have been, but maybe they don't need to stay that way. Or it may be that we need to see people in a new way to say, you know what, God, I need to love those people better than I have. And I need to care for those people a little better. And I need to serve those people better. But it's only going to happen sometimes. It's only going to happen when we see something old with a new perspective. Verse 5, and I said, O Lord God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments, let your ear be attentive and your eyes open to hear the prayer of your servant that I now pray before you day and night for the people of Israel, your servants, confessing the sins of the people of Israel which we have sinned against you. Even I and my father's house have sinned, and we have acted very corruptly against you and have not kept the commandments and the statutes and the rules that you commanded your servant Moses. Remember the word that you commanded your servant Moses, saying, if you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the peoples. But if you return to me and keep my commandments and do them, though your outcasts are in the uttermost parts of heaven, from there I will gather them and bring them to the place that I have chosen to make my name dwell there. They are your servants and your people, whom you have redeemed by your great power and by your strong hand. O Lord, let your ear be attentive to the prayer of your servant and to the prayer of your servants who delight to fear your name, and give success to your servant today and grant him mercy in the sight of this man. Now I was cupbearer to the king. Now you really have to understand, he's praying to God, but he's also asking for favor in front of the king. We'll get to what he does in front of the king next week in chapter 2. But notice this beautiful prayer. Man, he confesses his sin, his family's sin. And I think it's interesting that he's heartbroken over the state of his country about an event that happened 141 years ago. And he also is willing to say, I'm part of the problem. Now, once you think about that, us Christian folks, we're not too good sometimes about saying maybe we're part of the problem. Like, you know, we want a revival in our nation, but, you know, it's got to start with revival in our churches. Like it's not people that don't love Jesus' fault that they act like they don't know Jesus, but it is the problem of the folks that know Jesus that don't act like Jesus. That's where we need to start. And he says, I've sinned, my family sinned, we have sinned. And he also says, God, the reason we've been destroyed is because we didn't do what you told us to begin with. Maybe we should repent, he says, and get our hearts back to you. And then he says, but we know you're a God that's gracious, and that if we will do those things, what you'll do, you'll bring us back. And he says this, and it's a beautiful picture, because Nehemiah is also a man defined by prayer. Okay, he was a man of faith and a man of concern and care, but he also had a great faith in the Lord. And we see that because he is a man defined by prayer. He had a deep understanding of who God is. If you will read this, all he is doing is recounting biblical history, saying, this is who you are, God, and this is what you've done. And so even if you were to look at the whole book, there's 9 prayers recorded in this book, all personal, where Nehemiah says, God, I got to come to you for this, and I need to pray to you. And folks, if we're going to be a healthy church, if we're going to be the church that God's called us to be, we need to be people defined by prayer. There's no other way around it. Any revival recorded in human history was always preceded by prayer. Now, sure, it's an outwork of God. It's something that only the Holy Spirit can do, but it's preceded always by prayer. Are you a person defined by prayer? Because we need to be people defined by prayer. I say that to myself just as much as I say that to you. We need to be people defined by prayer. But a question has to be asked. How is it just now that Nehemiah is so broken? That has to be asked. As I just said, you know, he gets old news, but he gets it in a new way, or he hears it in a new way, or maybe just that day he had done an extra amount of prayer and it finally gets him. But whatever it is, it's God's Spirit in his life that causes him to be changed. And that's why I wanted us, even this morning, to have a time of prayer for our nation. You know, because, yes, I love being an American. I mean, my dad was in the military. I've lived all over the world. I've seen some amazing things. And I'll be honest, I love America and I love Mississippi. I do. People that aren't from here, they don't understand. They just don't get it, right? This is a great place to live and raise a family, but we got problems. America's a great place, and it's the land of opportunity, and it's the only nation in the world that offers self-correctives, but we got problems and issues. And so we need to be people defined by prayer. Yes, we can love and honor and respect, but we also must pray, pray, and pray. The same thing in our church. We must learn to see life for what it really is. And what I mean by that is this. Nehemiah, thousands of miles from his home country, 141 years removed from what has already happened, already knowing all the things he's about to hear, finally, he actually starts to see things as they really are. I'm going to be honest with you, folks. I've served in Simpson County, and I know the county, but the county's changed a lot in 10 years, okay, in good ways and bad ways. But Simpson County is a dark county that needs the gospel. You've got neighbors that need the gospel. You've got family members that need Jesus. You've got poverty. You've got drugs. You've got heartbroken people. You've got broken families. If our church is going to be the church that God's called it to be, we're going to have to see things as they really are. If you don't believe this city and this community is dark, I would encourage you to go talk to a bus driver. I lived a long time in Carthage, and it was only after I started driving a bus, a school bus, that I started seeing communities that I'd never even heard about. Communities that literally had no running water. And if you don't think that there's places to minister, go talk to a bus driver. They'll tell you where they are. You may even have bus drivers in here. I don't know. But they'll tell you that there's places to minister and to plug in to make a difference. We've got to see things as they really are. That starts internally. It starts when we say, God, who am I? Who have you called me to be? How am I being obedient or disobedient to how you have called me to live? It's an internal thing. Too often, we miss this, I think. And Nehemiah gets this in a new way. His heart's touched. And what does he do? The only thing he knows to do, he prays. He's heartbroken. He can't fix the situation. There's nothing he can do. He's thousands of miles away. He's already got this pretty important job. And he stops and he prays. And we'll see next week, he actually prays for months. He prays for months about what God's put on his heart. But he doesn't just pray. And this is going to be a point we'll get to next week. He doesn't just pray, he also makes plans, okay? He does both, okay? But we're not going to talk about planning this week. It's prayer this week, planning next week, but they go together. But while in a season of heartbreak, he prays, and then he makes some plans. And so when we think about this whole chapter, what can we see? What can we see and apply to our life? And first is this, again, I can't understress this or overstress this enough. We all need to be people defined by prayer. About 8:35, as I was trying to figure out how to wear this lapel mic that I just hit, okay, and I'm going to hit this thing like crazy. I use my hands a lot. It's just going to be like that. Y'all just going to have to get used to it. I'm sorry. All right, it's just going to happen. But as I was getting all that situated and just trying to, you know, figure out what all was going on, your deacons came in with me and Jason and prayed for me. And I can't tell you what that did for me. You know why? Because prayer is a big deal. And too often we use it as an afterthought. We think, well, let me try. Let me work. Let me do this. Let me figure it out. All right, God, finally, now you can have it. How proud is that? How prideful is it for that? Prayer should not be our last resort. It should be our primary option, number one. And so what we see here is that we need to be people defined by prayer. John Bunyan, who wrote The Pilgrim's Progress, a book I would highly recommend you to read. There are some newer versions that are kind of not written 400 years ago, so it's easier to read. But he said this. He said, you can do more than pray after you have prayed, but you cannot do more than pray until you have prayed. Let me repeat that again. You can do more than pray after you've prayed, but you cannot do more than pray until you've prayed. And we need to be people defined by prayer. Second, I want us to see the importance of changing our perspective. Is that we need to be realistic about where we are and where we're headed. We need to be realistic in our own families and our marriages and the way we, the relationships we have with our kids and our neighbors, but we need to have a new perspective. You see, Nehemiah just gets old news in a new way, I think because he's a man of prayer and the Spirit finally spoke to him. Through the power of the Spirit, he was touched. And folks, moving forward will require all of us to honestly look at where we are in order to see where we're supposed to go. And that happens when we're people defined by prayer, but then when we change our perspective because of the prayers we're praying, things start to happen. You know, Ronald Reagan once said, great change begins at the dinner table. And I think there's a lot of wisdom in that. Because I think when you get groups of people sitting around food and actually sharing life together, you start to understand people and you can mold yourself towards a common purpose. I really believe that. In a day where we're go, sometimes, and I'm not saying that, you know, if you're not eating dinner as a family, like you're doing wrong. I'm not saying that. But I'm saying that when we can share food and we can share our lives with one another, all of a sudden good things can happen. And so, when we change our perspective, when we listen to others, it's only when he hears Hananiah's report that he's touched. And I believe when Hananiah's sharing this, I believe this man's broken himself. Nehemiah, that's awful. Our people they're just destroyed. There's nothing. And I think all of a sudden he's sitting here in the king's court with everything he could possibly have. He's like, you're right. I knew this, but you're right. And sometimes, and I believe this is politically, socially, economically, racially, I think when we just have meaningful relationships and meaningful conversations with people that aren't like us, all of a sudden God touches our hearts and things change. The same thing holds true in the church. So third, although this point is actually a point from next week, I want to say it now as introducing the topic for next week, is we also need to be people that make plans. We need to pray, yes, but we also need to make plans. And I'm just going to be honest, I'm a planner, and I'm good at that. I struggle with the praying. I think, man, my wife has rubbed off on me, and I feel like you give me a spreadsheet and a colored pencil and a map, man, I can plan it out. The problem is sometimes I don't pray about it. And you got to pray, right? You got to pray, but you got to plan. I remember one time there was a young man who was looking for a job. All right, he said, Brother Adam, I need you to help me, you know, pray for me about a job. I said, absolutely, man, I will. And I was like, well, what are you doing about it? He said, what do you mean I'm praying about it? I was like, well, that's fantastic. Do you have a resume? Have you knocked on a door? Have you shook somebody's hand and said, hey, I'm so-and-so, I need a job? Like, well, no. I was like, okay, now I'm not saying God can't give you a job. I am not. He's God of the universe. He can do whatever he wants. But I'm going to also offer this, that maybe you ought to put some feet to your prayer and get to work. They go together. We pray. And we plan. And just as we have servants and leaders, we have prayers and planners. We need both. So, as we look at that next week, in closing, are you a person defined by prayer? Only you can answer that question this morning. But are you a person defined by prayer? You need to be. And you can be. One of the beautiful things about the prayers that Nehemiah prays, they're all pretty short. He doesn't have these long, drawn-out prayers. And there are times that we have those. But there's some short ones in there, and I love that. They don't have to be long, drawn-out prayers to be effective. They just need to be honest. So are you a person defined by prayer? Second, are you a person that needs to change their perspective? Are you a person that needs to say, you know what, God, I need an honest assessment of where my life is. Maybe it's your marriage. Maybe it's your children. Maybe it's your job. Maybe it's just your health. It could be any number of things in your own life. But are you a person that needs to have a change in perspective? If you'll pray, God will change your perspective. And God will tell you what he needs you to do. Or if you're doing that and that's not getting you anywhere, you're in a church made up of a lot of people that have the same things going on in their life. And I promise you, there are people here that love to help you. I'd love to help. If you need a change of perspective, things going on in your life, if we will prayerfully bring them before the Lord, I believe God will change our perspective. Again, we all need to be people defined by prayer, but we all need to be people to have our perspectives changed. And when we get out of ourself, out of our comfort zone, I think God will do that. And that's my hope as we start the book of Nehemiah, is that we remember that it's not about us, it's about him. It's about doing what God would have us to do. And I think God wants to do great things here, I really do, but I promise it's not going to happen if we're not people defined by prayer, and it won't happen if we're not people that change our perspective. So, that being said, who's willing to do those things? To be people defined by prayer, and to be people defined by a perspective that's shared with one another as we move forward towards the gospel. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for your word that you've given us, you've honored us with. God, we thank you for the story of Nehemiah, how he was just willing to write down what happened in his own life, even his own prayer. And God, I pray that we would all be people of prayer. We'd be defined by prayer, God, that if there's things in our life that we need to get rid of, God, that we need to repent of, God, that you would change our perspective on those things, God, that we would not be comfortable where we are, but that we would be willing and able to do those things that you called us to do in order for us to be obedient. God, I pray for our church. I pray that as we get started on this season of life and ministry, God, that you would unite our hearts around you, that we would be people defined by prayer and prayer only to you, that we would make plans, sure, but that our perspectives would change as we seek to be the people you have called us to be. God, for whoever here this morning needs that change of perspective, God, I pray that they would pray even at the altar or even where they are, or with a leader here or myself. God, I just pray that we'd be obedient during this time to do what you called us to do. God, we love you. Move in our hearts and our spirit, even in this moment, God, as we pray. And it's in your name that we ask these things. Amen. We're going to have a time of invitation. Again, the altar will always be open at any point, okay? I'm not necessarily charismatic, but if you feel like you need to go to the altar while I'm preaching, you're not going to freak me out a bit, okay? I just want us all to be obedient to what God would have. But if you need prayer, there's people here that would pray with you. I'd be happy to pray with you. But whatever God would have you to do this morning, okay, I pray that you'd be obedient to that.
Because he lives 449, stand as we sing.